if you're not looking forward to waking up in the morning, why do it? When something happens that's more than a coincidence, I pay a lot of attention to it. You're going to push a button and the doors are going to go up. I got to introduce you to a guy you're going to love to meet, Bruce Myers from the Myers Manx. And Bruce is one of the best human beings, one of the nicest human beings you want to meet in your lifetime. I'm now learning about the car business painfully. Another million. A month and a half from production, I don't have the doors I want. Mr. Bricklin, we have a problem. What's that? American Motors said they are not going to sell us engines. If you take that position, you're pushing me out the window. And if you push me out the window, I'm grabbing a hold of your tie because I'm landing on your stomach. And what does that mean? It means I'm leaving here and I'm going straight to Washington. And I'm going to tell them how you and the rest of the car companies are in collusion to put me out of business because of the safety things that I'm putting in my car. How can I build a car if I think the body's going to fall off? Malcolm, he said, you're not going to like what I got to tell you. Yeah, okay. What is it, Mr. Premier? He says, I'm closing it down.
Jeff Stearns, connected through cars. If they're bigwigs, we'll have them on the show. And yes, we'll talk about cars and everything else. Here he is now, Jeff Stearns.
Phenomenal story. Like, I didn't even know this. I'm so excited to hear this. This is amazing. I'm so happy to meet you, Malcolm. Honest to God. I mean, you know.
My pleasure. Jeff, it's my pleasure.
Really, you know, because I've known your name since I'm 10 years old-ish. I wish my dad was still around. If
what are you,
knew,
about 56 or 57?
55.
Because I have three sons that are older than you, 60, 58, and 56. So you're a fourth son. I got a 44 and a 34 and a 29 also.
Got it. Well, I have a little bit because I have an 18 and 21-year-old and a five-month-old.
Oh, way to go. All right.
So I'm in the Malcolm Club. What can I tell
you?
Yeah, you are. So how does it go from that to, okay, so I always wondered when you were importing Yugo and importing Fiat, I'm like, I wonder how he got into, like, I know that, for example, people in the clothing business, right, Schmata, they're going overseas and or to Italy or to Asia or whatever, or France, and they're doing their buying. And I'm like, how did this guy just like find this car, or that car? But now I understand that from the scooters to the Subaru, you know, the 360 and the Subaru. Now I understand how you got your taste for that. So how does it go to your own car, Bricklin, and what was behind that?
Okay. So now one of the traumatic things in my life was Consumer Report saying I had a piece of crap because it was unsafe.
Yep. Because it was unregulated.
And they assumed it was unsafe because it was unregulated. Now, it was unsafe because it was small. No matter how much regulations I would have put on that car, if two trucks went smashed in between, you'd be smashed in between. But the truth of the matter is it was a monocoque body. So it was like if you hit it, because it was light, it would go like a ping pong ball. And that would take all the energy from the person inside, because instead of standing there and getting the energy, it would go.
So now, other than the thing you mentioned, other than getting sandwiched,
right,
it's going to bounce and absorb
safer,
energy.
Safer than a normal car would be. And it wasn't unsafe because we didn't need the safety rules. It was just small. End of story. But it pissed me off.
Do you have a copy? Do you have a copy of that Consumer Report?
I went out of my way to make sure I didn't.
Oh, sorry.
Don't
mean
to bring up trauma. And it would be, no, it wasn't. It was trauma then. It would have been about 69 or 70. Just put the Consumer Report that had a picture of the Cadillac face to face with the Subaru 360, or the bad article about Subaru back in the early 60s.
Okay.
All right. So, but anyhow, that was in my head. It never left. It really annoyed me because I did nothing I could do to answer it because they were going down a premise I couldn't argue with. Didn't have to meet the regulations.
you said earlier, you're not motivated by the money. You know, it's not the money. And when you were, when you had these machines that the MTV before the MTV at the checkout stands that you sold so easily, and it probably was decent money or at least a proven business model. And it, you said, it didn't turn me on. It wasn't right. My thing. So you really are about the passion, no doubt about it.
Oh, 100%. 100%. Yeah. Because if you can't, if you're not looking forward to waking up in the morning, why do it? This
right.
I enjoy. This I enjoy. Doing, thinking, talking, doing, meeting. That I enjoy. That's what my life is about. And I want to live a long time for no particular reason, except something else happened that was the way divine wine works. When something happens that's more than a coincidence, I pay a lot of attention to it. But that's another story. The end of the story, yeah, I am passionate about what I do. And I can do anything. I can be passionate about sweeping the floor. As long as there's something I'm adding to what I'm doing, I'm willing to do it.
Beautiful. So I think we started talking about the Bricklin car before we break.
Okay. So you got this thing in my head, safety, part of my nagging over here.
Oh, because the consumer reports. Okay.
And yep. I can't answer it. No matter what I say, nobody gives a damn. They were right with what they argument. They were wrong in their conclusion. Anyhow. But it got me my bigger car. So the end of the story is, thank God they did that. Because if I didn't get the bigger car, the 360 eventually would not have been okay, no matter what.
Okay.
Today it would be bad, okay, but not me. Anyhow, so it got me the bigger car. Now things are going really good with Subaru. And I'm hearing all this stuff about safety. And they're talking about putting rules that you had to have a 5-mile-an-hour bumper with no damage to the car. And the car companies are fighting it like crazy. Because at 5 miles an hour, you get a couple $1,000s worth of damage. That's parts and service the dealer can make. That's parts that the factories can sell. So they were fighting it. And their argument was, if you keep giving us all these regulations, the cars are going to have to be looking very ugly to design them safe. And people aren't going to buy them. And therefore, the industry is going to be ruined. That's their argument. I'm coming from, why in the hell are they saying that? I know why they're saying it. Nobody can believe that. That's all bullshit. I am going to build a gorgeous car. It's going to be the safest production car in the world. That went through my head. On top of that, I, with my kids, on Saturday morning, would watch cartoons. And one of the cartoons of the era was 1999, A Space Odyssey or Space Something. And it was a show with real people instead of cartoons on the moon. And the beginning of the show, every show, as what their format was, a car would come out quietly and the doors would go up quietly. And I fell in love with the doors in the car. And I couldn't wait to see the 15 seconds every Saturday of that particular thing and said, I'm building a car like that. You're going to push a button and the doors are going to go up. And now I'm going to build it and make it the safest car in the world. And I'm going to have 25-mile-an-hour bumpers, no damage. And I'm going to find the material that you can't dent. Don't know what I'm talking about, but I'm saying it. So I go out to figure out what I got to do. I have offices in California. One of the guys I meet, Alan Rapinski, the guy that invented Armorall, is hanging around and trying to get involved with me. And I give him a job prior to Armorall. And he says, I got to introduce you to a guy you're going to love to meet. Bruce Myers from the Myers Manx. And Bruce is one of the best human beings, one of the nicest human beings you want to meet in your lifetime.
He's sick right now. I talked to Winnie, his wife, about 2 weeks ago. He's not doing well.
Well, that I'm sorry to hear. But there's a really special human being. So if you happen to talk to her, please give her my love for him. All right. So now I get together with Bruce. And of course, I love him because I had bought an Myers Manx. My kids and I used to drive around in Philadelphia all over the neighborhood and pick up the other kids and go drive in the dune buggy. So I tell him what I want to do and I need a prototype. So we play with it, we design it, and he builds me a prototype. Now, not the normal way you build it, not the real way. I don't know from anything. I just see a car that's pretty close to what I like. Doors don't open except by hand, you know, you need a thing to hold them. And we got an engine from, I don't remember where the hell we got an engine. But it looked pretty close, and it's called the Grey Ghost. So I have this car. I send it back to Philadelphia, and I have pictures of the car going with my rolls behind it, and I had a Lamborghini Espada, and I had that there. And then I'd open the doors next to the car because the gold wing opens like this so you can get out this when you have this much room. And I used it to go take it to the banks so I could borrow money on my Subaru stock so I could start to fund this thing. But I got to get to the next step of getting it ready for manufacturing, and I get introduced to people who know what they're doing in the real car business. After they look over my prototype, they tell me there will be not one nut or bolt in the real car that you got in this car over here. There's nothing over here that we're going to ever be able to copy. So that was my first shock. Instead of 2 cents, it's going to cost me a couple million dollars to get my prototypes. We had to build a clay model to 1/10,000 of an inch. Then we have to pull a plaster, which ruins the clay. Then we have to have a wood model made. And it has to take care of the shrinkage that's going to take in when you make the acrylic. Well, I don't know about acrylic yet. I'm still looking for the body. So we're getting to what kind of body they want. They want me to do steel. I don't want to do steel. Then they go fiberglass. I don't want to do fiberglass. It runs. I had a couple Corvettes. So I'm looking around, and I get to Roman Haas, who builds acrylic sheets. And they use these acrylic sheets, which are solid color, in bathtubs, in bathrooms. Put it on the wall. Boom, you got a new wall. Okay. Tell me about it. Well, if you get a scratch, you just buff it out. If you're running for a car, you reinforce it with fiberglass. You can't make a dent. If you hit it hard enough to make a dent, you make a hole. And you can put the hole right back in. Put glue on, buff it, you got your body back. No kidding. By the way, at 35 mile an hour crashes, it goes into the wall, the fenders crack and go off. I can put the fenders back, glue them in the back. All right. So now I got acrylic reinforced with fiberglass. Oh, isn't that great? Now they got to make molds and they got to figure in just a million different things. I had no idea. And we're doing it. And I'm now learning about the car business painfully, another million. And I'm talking little millions. I'm not talking billions like they talk now. And then I got to get a motor from somebody, an engine, safety regulations. You can't build engines anymore. And that not then, because you had to meet all the safety things. It was just out of the question. The amount of money you needed to build it, to create an engine and the transmission and meet all the regulations was too much serious money. So I had to buy it from somebody. So we got an American Motors 360, 4-barrel, nice engine. We got a contract from them, $1,000 a month. We put it in. We had to meet a 50,000-mile test, which is a royal pain in the ass. We met the 50,000-mile test. Now, we don't have bumpers. The 25 miles is out. I'm finally convinced that's way too much stuff. I'll have to have a bumper about this big to go in that much and then come out that much. Oh, my God. It will look ugly. Be stupid. I mean, just nothing good. So I find, okay, great. But we still don't have, what are we going to do to have this happen? We're going to build the body around the bumper so it can go in and out without hurting the body. I'm flying into LA one day, and as we land, it hits me. What did we just do? We just landed a plane. The wheels went in and out. That's what I want. I get off the plane, get in the taxi, go to the company that makes the wheel mechanism to close, that keeps the wheels going back and forth when you land. And I tell them what I want to do. Yeah, so I say, here's what I want to do. Here's what the car is going to weigh. I want 10-mile-an-hour bumpers. Can you get them for me? They said, of course. They ended up making me 2 little units for the front and 2 units for the back. Each one cost me $1.50. I have 10-mile-an-hour bumpers. Now, that would not make General Motors or Ford or Chrysler happy, because for their lousy $1.50, they just lost a couple thousand dollars worth. Now, the bumper was sturdier than a normal bumper, and it cost more money. I'm exaggerating on how low it cost, but it didn't cost very much. Now, I have a body that won't dent. I have an exterior that will look the same. I told him 40 years from now, it's 47 years, it'll look exactly the same. All you have to do is buff them. And if you want, you can paint them. It doesn't matter. Now, we have to build a dozen of them to send them around the country to find out what happens in the mountains and what happens in the hot and what happens in the cold. Let's find out what the hell happens with our wonderful vehicles. Oh, the first thing is nobody will give me the door I want. I got a gull wing. I insist on a glass that goes up and down. By the way, no gull wing door ever made has a window that goes up and down, because the physics of it when it's out, when it's down, and when it's up is so dramatically different that what you need is whatever. And my guys refused to find a solution. They wanted to talk me out of the glass, and they wanted to talk me out of a push button. They wanted to go by hand, and I refused. I remember now we're a month and a half from production. No, excuse me. Yeah, a month and a half from production. I'll tell you about the engine in a minute. Month and a half from production, I don't have the doors I want. The reason I built the car, I can't have the doors. And at that time, there wasn't computers designing the car. I had 200 engineers sitting in Livonia drawing the engineering for a year. And I'm walking out to the car to go to the airport, and I'm really frustrated. And a kid comes running after me that works inside. He said, "Mr. Bricklin," he said, "I can get you what you want." I said, "Hey, really? What is it?" He said, "You take the hydraulic cylinder from the convertible that takes the convertible up and down, and you put it on the B pillar, and you push a button, it'll open, and you push a button, it'll close." No kidding. "Why don't you tell them?" He said, "Oh, I've told them." He said, "They're not interested in doing it. And in fact, if you do it, when you leave, I'm getting fired." "Oh, really? Come here with me, kid." I walk in, I call everybody in. I said, "This gentleman just told me a very interesting solution. And I have to tell you, I'm excited. I know it'll work. So I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to leave. I'll be back next week. If it's on the car and working, we're in production. If it's not on the car and working, I'm closing the place. We're not building the car. And if anybody messes with the kid, they're getting fired." Came back a week later, you pushed a button and it worked. All right. And I'll tell you the end story with that. But now I got the doors that work. And I have, because it's hydraulic enough for the glass to be either way. I got no more problem. Everything is solved. Things are ready to go. Now back off another 4 or 5 months before that. And I get a call from my guys that say, "Mr. Bricklin, we have a problem." "What's that?" "American Motors said they are not going to sell us engines." I said, "What do you mean they're not going to sell us engines? We met the 50,000 mile test. We're going to be in production 4 or 5 months. We got a contract with them. What do you mean we're not telling what's in?" "They told me we're not selling you any engines." So I said, "Well, who the hell is the president?" And I forget what his name is now. Whoever was the president at the time, it was a really rough and came from the bottom up kind of guy. I call his office. And I say, "I am in a very serious problem. I've been told that you're not going to honor a contract. And before I have to go in a different direction, I want the courtesy of a meeting with you tomorrow. I'm bringing my people. Please give me a time." She came back to me, gave me a time. Let's say it was 9:30. A couple of my people and I are there. He has a couple of his people. And I start telling him, "Listen, if you don't sell me your engines, I'm going to go out of business. I engineered the car with your engine in it. I met the 50,000 mile test with the engine in it. I did all my other tests around the country with your engine in it. I need your engine." He said, "Mr. Bricklin," he said, "I've been trying to sell my cars for a long time, and it's really hard. Now there's a market out there. Every car I build, I sell. So that means every engine I sell you, I don't sell that car. And if you think I'm going to sell you engines instead of the car, you're out of your mind." I said, "Well, let me be real clear about my position. If you take that position, you're pushing me out the window. And if you push me out the window, I'm grabbing a hold of your tie because I'm landing on your stomach. And what does that mean? It means I'm leaving here and I'm going straight to Washington. And I'm going to tell them how you and the rest of the car companies are in collusion to put me out of business because of the safety things that I'm putting in my car. And I guarantee you wish you sold me my goddamn engines." I said, "And if you want to fuck me, you're going to fuck me, but it's going to cost you." "You son of a bitch." And he said worse than that. "How dare you? Bah, 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 bah. I'm selling you 700 engines. Now get somebody else to get engines from then on. Get the fuck out of my office." I said, "Thank you so much." I said, "I apologize if anything I said was crude or not polite, but I was desperate and you've solved my desperation. So please excuse me. I said, "Just get out of my office." Lunenburg, that was his name. Lunenburg. All right. So now I had 700 that were going to come in. I needed another engine. Oh my God, I got to start over. This is not what I want to do. And I got to do it right away. About a couple of days later, I'm sitting in the Livonia office and I'm with Keith Crane, who is there to convince me not to be an asshole. Because I've told everybody there'll be no stories about what we're doing until I'm ready to introduce it. And he tried to sneak in to get a picture of it and so forth. And my guys took his camera and broke it. And he said, "You're making a mistake. We're very powerful." I said, "I don't give a shit." And he started convincing me why he would make a sin. He said, "By the way, why is Al Smirlik out in your waiting room?" I said, "Who's Al Smirlik?" He said, "He's Iacocca's right-hand man." "Ah, no kidding." I said, "Keith, you know what? I'm going to give you a story. Go ahead. Arrange when you want to have it. I'll do the interview and you can take pictures of what we got right now. I'll see you later. Goodbye." I push him out of the office. I bring Hal Smirlik in. Hey, Hal, how are you? Nice to meet you. Tell me, you working for Iacocca? Yeah, I'm his right-hand man. Bah, 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 bah. I said, you're just the man I want to see. You know, I was thinking I'm buying the American Motors 360, but I'm building it in Canada, and they would like me to have more Canadian content. What do you think I should, is it possible to get the 351 Windsor? He said, oh, yeah, no problem. I said, great, draw up a contract. I'm to hell with American Motors. I'm going to use your car. I mean, I got to buy some of their engines now, but I'm going to give it. How fast can I get some price things so I can start the 50,000-mile test? Blah, 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 blah. Anyhow, we ended up, that's how we ended up with the Windsor 350.
Now, that story is not over. Oh, go ahead.
Huh?
Go ahead.
That's not the end of the story. Now I got a contract with them. Now we met them 50,000-mile test again. Now it's December, around Christmas, about 19th, right before Christmas. I'm in the L.A. airport in the VIP room waiting to get on a plane to go to Acapulco with my family for Christmas for, I think, 10 days, which we did every year. I get a call from my secretary. Got a call from Ford. They're not going to sell us the engines. Oh, no. Please don't suck this. Now I start making calls. First, to Henry Ford. He doesn't take my call. Then to Iacocca. He doesn't take my call. Then to Sperlick. He takes my call. I say, what the hell is going on? He says, I have no idea. I'll get back to you. I said, please do. I am on my way to Acapulco. If the answer is I got no problem, I'm going to continue that road. If the answer is I got a problem, I'm changing my vacation and I'm going to Washington. Came the same story. And I said, I don't believe this is the way you treat people. I wouldn't have changed if I had that ababath. He calls me back. He says, okay, you got it. I said, what was the problem? He said, the lawyer said, how many motors are we going to sell? Who needs the liability? And they're not wrong, by the way. You know, if anything happened to the car, they're going to sue them too. Anyhow, so that catastrophe got over really fast without me having to be nasty or say anything I'd rather not say. And Halsberg, what a sweetheart he is. And so we had that engine and that happened. Now, the last story, we have people out all over the country testing the car. I get a call one night from one of the guys because everybody had my phone. They knew they could call it whenever. And that was before cell phones, by the way. And he said, Mr. Bricklin, we got a serious problem. Yeah. What's the problem? I said, well, I'm in Scottsdale. I've been driving the car in 114 degree heat. It's July or August in Scottsdale. He said, when we take the car, we park it inside in an air conditioned, probably 65 or 70 degree garage. Okay. Well, I came out and the acrylic body is on the floor. What are you talking about? He said, the acrylic separated from the fiberglass and is sitting on the ground. I said, all the pieces? He said, yeah. I said, well, how could that happen? It's because we glued it and fiberglass and acrylic move at different temperatures, different times. So they broke apart. Oh, my God. All I need is one car to do that. And I'm out of business. I can't even imagine doing that. And I say to him, do you have any idea what the solution would be? They said, yeah, very simple. You need a bonding material that will go into both materials and be flexible enough for them to move at different rates. Really? No problem. Call up Roma and Haas. We know about acrylic. We don't know anything about fiberglass. Call up. I forget the fiberglass people. Call up the we know everything about fiberglass. We don't. In other words, both of us go fuck myself. They ain't got no solution, and they have no intention to try to figure it out. So I call a meeting of all my people, none of which do I have a chemist on board, by the way. And I tell them what the problem is. And I tell them, one, we can't have one. And we have to invent that bond. And we got exactly 10 days to do it. Or we can't build a car. I got to stop everything from coming in. How can I build a car if I think the body's going to fall off under any circumstance? They invented it. Nobody ever fell off. No piece ever fell off. We never had a problem. It was like it never existed. To this day, I have no idea how that was possible.
You've had a few nail biters in your life.
Whoa, that was the nail biter of every nail biter I've had in my universe. That one scared the crap out of me.
So do you have a Bricklin car?
I had five and I gave them away to museums. I'm not a collector. I don't collect anything. My kid, my oldest son, has storage areas all over the country with Bricklin crap. I don't have anything.
How much was the car new?
How much did it sell for new? It sold for $9,998. It started off, it was going to sell for like $3,500. But I kept putting more shit in there.
Well, this is what I hope doesn't happen with the new Bricklin. Again, I don't want to jinx anything.
Oh, no, no. The difference is I started from pricing it out before I decided to go further.
I'm looking online while I'm talking to you because now I want one so bad. And there's just because now I know the Bubba Mesa, right? So 1, 2, 3, 4. There's four for sale on Classic Trader.
How much?
And one's an auction announcement, so don't know. Another one with 40,000 miles and a 351 is they're asking 14.5. Another one with a 360. Did you have a 360?
Yeah, that's a 360 American Motors 360 4 barrel.
Okay, I thought those were the 3.
It was the first 700.
Okay. Huh? The AMC was a 340, I thought. So, but the AMC,
it was a 360. It's a 360.
Okay. 29 grand with 12,000 miles. And finally, the one that I want is a white and tan 17,000 mile one owner in San Diego for 26.8.
In the late 20s or early 30s is where most of them are selling. As soon as we come out with the Bricklin 3 EV, the car prices will go up dramatically. Because what will happen is if you have one of each, you have something that's never going to be duplicated. So you can have 3,000 of the other ones, maybe 500 are probably off the road someplace, vegetating. So they will be very rare as a set.
We need to corner the market on all of them.
I'm thinking about that. I've been jokingly thinking about that because it's more work than I'm willing to do.
Why did the Bricklin cease production? Is that a story or no?
Oh, it's a story. We have, at the time, 46,000 back orders. Got 400 dealers. Can't bring them in fast enough. They're getting over lists for the car. I got some problems I got to figure out. Some production problems that are interesting problems, one of which I'll tell you, which is another scary. So we're building them, and we're trying to fix the things that we need to be fixed as fast as we can. And one day, in my home in Philadelphia, I have a Bricklin, and I have it with the doors up as often as I can have it. And I'm looking at it all the time because that car with the doors up just to this day just gets my attention. I love looking at it. And I'm looking at the car and it starts to rain, but not a normal rain, one of those fast rains that comes pouring down. So I run out to shut the doors. Now remember the hydraulic. If you have the hydraulic go too fast, you maybe cut your hand off if you don't do something smart. So I push the button and it takes 6 seconds for the door to close. Did you ever stand in the rain for 6 seconds? All right, now, but first I got to jump in, and now I'm inside and I'm closing in. It's raining in on me. So it means in the rain, normally I have to wait 6 seconds for it to open, jump in, and 6 seconds. Oh my God. This is the most horrible. This is the next worst thing to the bodies coming apart. But I got cars out. They're out there. They're already delivered, and I'm building more. Oh my God. What am I going? I remember it was hard as hell to get this solution. What am I going to do? I got to change it. This is not acceptable. So I called my friend, Frank Turner, in Graham, Texas, who he's no longer alive, a great inventor, not a good inventor, a great inventor. And I said, Frank, I got a problem flying to Detroit. Somebody will pick you up and you got to solve the problem for me. So he comes in, I show him the door and I said, I need the door to go boom. And I need the door to come down and stop. And then comes close slowly so it doesn't cut off anybody's finger. And I got to do it so I can put it into the car that I got right now. I said, okay, no problem. I'll be back in a week. He said, give me a car. So I give him a car and he drives to Graham, Texas. The end of the week, he calls me. I'm there. Come on in. So I fly in. Everybody walks out to the car. He pushes a button. It goes, whoop. He pushes another button. It goes, whoop. Stops 6 inches above and closes. This is fantastic. What do I have to change? Nothing. He said, I took the hydraulic fluid out of the hydraulic lift and put in air. And you have a box frame. Your engine makes air and it pumps in into the box frame. That's it. We didn't get one of the cars in production on because we got closed down before we could do it. But 90% of the cars on the road today have that in because some people who left the factory to go be in their business of fixing Bricklins put them on all the cars that come walking in, they want to be fixed. And it's fabulous. Not good. That boom, boom. That's simple.
How many ended up getting delivered and how many got retailed?
3,000. 3,000 got delivered. 46,000 back orders from dealers. I'll give you the last story on that. When I met him, the reason I was there is because he was willing to give me the first $3 million from outside source other than my own money. And he did it because he told me clearly he wanted attention to the province so they wouldn't think of them only as people who go fishing and cut wood, that they see they're right out there with the futuristic automobiles, safety automobiles. And he thinks we'll get a lot of attention, and that's what he wants for the money. All right. And by the way, we were on talk shows together. We were at Harvard Business School together. He got his money's worth plus and was happy as hell about the attention New Brunswick knew nobody ever heard of, including me, before the car. So, and we became friends. I mean, we really became good friends. And he was what I consider a really true good politician. Gave a shit about one thing, doing good for the province, was not married, worked 24 hours a day, lived in a shitty little hotel. That, I mean, if you're homeless, you wouldn't hardly live there because he just worked all the time. He comes in one day. I mean, I'm talking about a good friend. He comes in one day. By that time, I think I'd gotten about $20 million from him, which was a lot of money back then. By the way, I did the whole damn project for $35 million. It cost DeLorean $500 million. It cost people now $2 billion to do. So I did everything on $35 million. Not important. What is important is he comes in and says, Malcolm, he said, you're not going to like what I got to tell you. Yeah, okay. What is it, Mr. Premier? He says, I'm closing it down. I said, that's not a good joke. He said, it's not a joke. I said, why would you be closing us down? I got 45,000 back orders. You're paying people union wages. They're getting paid more than they ever got paid in their life, and they're loving it. And you got publicity up the gazoo. Why would you even consider closing us down? He said, well, unintended circumstances. What's that? He said, last month, I came to you and I said, give me 3 Bricklins. And you said, what are they for? And I said, I'm calling an election. First car is going to be a Bricklin's going to get the crowds. The second car is going to come with my mother in it. And the third car is going to be me. And he did. And the day after the election, the front cover of all the papers had him in a Superman costume flying out of the top of a Bricklin. And the headlines in bold print was, Premier wins the Bricklin election. I say, I got it knocked. I own this place. He said, we got all that and it was all true. Now, let me tell you about my life. Every day I wake up, I have my breakfast, and I go have my daily press meetings. There are 2 questions they want to answer. How's Malcolm and what's happening with the car? They have no interest in anything else I got to say. So I'm banking. I close you down, I get abuse, a year from now I call another election, and I win it on my own or not. And that's exactly what he did. He closed us down, and he called another election a year later, and he won the election, and it was his. And that's the end of the story. Thank God. Because otherwise, not that I thought it was thank God then, at that time. I mean, for damn sure I didn't think it was thank God. I thought, oh my God. But I would be stuck with a car factory. I'd have to come up with a new car. I don't want to own a car factory, to tell you the truth. I might have to own one, but I'd rather not, for sure. And I damn sure don't want to have anything to do with political money in any way, shape, or form. If I can't get our money by public and me putting it in, the hell with it. It ain't going to happen. I don't want any political involvement. It's just not good, because that happens. And that's the last thing in the world. They won the election based on our car, and now they're going to close it down. That's ballsy.
I'll tell you what. I mean, you've had a...
By the way, they did a musical.
It happened that they had to wait a while to say thank God.
Oh, yeah, that's true. But they did a musical a couple years back up there called Bricklin, an Automotive Fantasy. And the story I just told you, don't ask me how they got that story. They must have been in politics. The writers wrote what I just told you, but they did it in a musical that I saw, and it was a fabulous musical.
A cowboy entrepreneur and a flamboyant premier dare to change the automotive industry forever.
Ring on that Bricklin. We want the Bricklin.
I'm gonna give it a shot. You know.
Big dreams collide with sports cars. in the sexy, funk-infused musical. Audiences can't wait to take for a ride.
This has been Jeff Stearns, Connected Through Cars.